and welcome to another watercolor painting tutorial. If you're new around here, welcome! My name is Anna, and today we're gonna walk through how to create this fall forest scenery together. I used the Winsor & Newton cold press watercolor paper for this tutorial, which has kind of been my go-to paper for a while now, especially whenever I want to use a little bit higher quality paper to create those really blown out and seamless backgrounds. But now, let's just get started, and the way we're gonna work with this painting is by doing a lot of layering, and whenever you're working with watercolors, you always want to start from the lightest layers and then gradually build all the darker details on top. So we're gonna start from the very background of this forest first and not even think about adding trees or any other details in this point. I'm using the wet on wet technique, which means that we're pretty much gonna cover this whole piece of paper with clean water first, and then we're gonna start adding the colors, and since the paper is already wet, now the paints will blend very beautifully and there won't be any harsh edges. So the first thing I wanted to achieve for this background was this lighter circle in the middle, and then fading that very seamlessly to a little bit darker colors around the edges. In the final painting, this will create a very pretty sunset type of effect that we are watching through the forest. So I started by placing these darker colors to the edges first, and then without picking too much color anymore, I started to slowly fade the colors towards the middle. Again, it's very important that this whole area is wet, otherwise you might get some harsh lines around the middle, which is not what we want, of course. This is also a step where you kind of have to work pretty quickly. So if you feel like your paper starts to dry, just take a little bit more water to your brush and then try to blend the colors that are already on the paper with a little bit more water. I was using these very warm, orangey brown tones a lot in this painting, and then I wanted to add some contrast to that with these green tones towards the bottom of this painting. I think these colors look very beautiful together, but you could also leave out the green and just add a little bit darker brown to the lower part if you want to go for a little bit less colorful version. In general, this first layer definitely doesn't have to be perfect. All the space in the sides and also the bottom part won't really show in the final picture. And then something I often experience with watercolors is that after everything has dried, it looks a little bit less vibrant and lighter than I thought. So I actually decided to add a second very similar layer on top of this first one that gives you a really good opportunity to fix any parts you didn't like and maybe add the color intensity a little bit more. So it's very important to let this first layer completely dry, and then I started by wetting this whole paper again and going in with the second layer almost as if the first one didn't even exist. I thought that my light circle in the middle here was a little bit too big, so I added more of these orangey tones to the sky, and I also wanted to darken up the lower greenish part a little bit more. And then in the very end, I also started to add some of these plops of color towards the edges that will represent some faraway trees and leaves in the final picture. But now, after these two wet on wet background layers, we're from now on gonna work on dry background, which will create a little bit more defined shapes for us. So I started to add these random shapes to the sides and also towards the bottom. And also in this point, you can start to experiment with some light tree trunks across the whole paper. Again, this will probably dry very light, so in the final picture, these first trees and leaf groups will look like the trees further away. And it's just a great way to add some dimension to your forest. I also kept adding even darker layers towards the bottom because I wanted this very bottom part to be pretty much black and create quite a lot of contrast with the lighter colors in the middle. And then after all these details had dried again, it's now time to add even darker and bigger tree trunks. And these will end up being the ones that are the closest to us in the final picture. I was again struggling to keep the paints as dark as I wanted, so I actually had to go over a few of these trees later. In general, you get a very dark pigment and dark colors by adding less water and more paint to your brushes, but it might sometimes be a little bit difficult to kind of find the perfect balance between still being able to create smooth strokes. So if you feel like the colors don't look as dark when everything has dried out, you can always just add a second layer on top. I also started to add more leaves and these small branches here and there. And also these ones will gradually get a little bit darker and darker. I actually wish I had used the initial warm browns a little bit more in the leaves here, especially for the ones closer to the middle. If I would paint this whole picture again, I would probably do that and try to add even more brightness to these warm browns and orange tones. I feel like now I maybe used a little bit too much of my sepia brown and black tones in the edges of the painting, which, I mean, it's not a bad thing, but it just took a little bit away from all the brightness. And then when it comes to the leaves, you can get really far with just tapping on the colors. And I also tried this dry brush method a little bit here and there, where I added some of these leaves with a slightly dry brush, so you can kind of see the texture and effect it creates here. I think this method suits pretty well with leaves. But after that, this is the point where you just continue these same steps for as long as you're finally happy with the intensity and darkness of everything. So when I felt like I was somewhat happy with the forest, I removed the tapes around my edges just to see how everything looks. In this point, I wasn't sure if I wanted to add the deer silhouette or if I should just leave everything here, but eventually, for the sake of the tutorial, I decided that it would be more fun to add the deer here as well. So I actually took my pencil in this point and very lightly tried to sketch out the deer a little bit. If you're brave enough, you can go in without the sketch, but I thought this will probably create a little bit better end result. Whenever I draw animals like this, I usually start by searching some pictures of them just to get the shape and size of everything as correct as possible. And with this one, we only really need to consider the edges of the deer. We're not gonna paint any fur or facial detail or anything like that. It will just be the dark shape of the deer. And after that, I took a little bit smaller brush and just started to color this all in. I used the same darker brown and black tones and also left the top part of the deer a little bit lighter and then tried to fade the bottom part to the ground. But after that, that's finally it for this whole fall forest scenery. This picture ended up being much more difficult for me than I thought. I definitely need to paint more watercolor landscapes in the future. But at the same time, I thought this was such a good practice, especially for the layering aspect of watercolors. And if you like this end result, I think I will edit this a little bit digitally to get it to the place I initially wanted. And then I will probably add this to my shop as an art print. So if you're interested in that, the links are in the description. But I think that's all I can think about for this time. Thank you guys so much for watching as always. I hope you're having an amazing day or night wherever you are. And see you in my next one. Bye bye!